Everybody seems to be talking about Bitcoin these days. And as it turns 12 today, in this video we're going to be covering what exactly Bitcoin is and some of its key features. So if you want to know more about Bitcoin, stick around. Hi, Ante here. On this channel, we'll teach you everything you want to know about Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies in general. If you have any questions about the content, feel free to leave them in the comment section and I'll make sure to make a video about it in the future. So, what is Bitcoin? Let's start with the definition. According to Investopedia, Bitcoin is a digital currency or a cryptocurrency, which means that it exists purely in digital form and is secured by cryptography. It was created in 2008 following a housing market crash by a person or a group of people called Satoshi Nakamoto, authoring a 9-page white paper called Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. The system itself was subsequently released as open source software on January the 3rd, 2009, making it 12 years old as of making this video. Another way of defining Bitcoin is as follows. It is a distributed, anonymous, and decentralized peer-to-peer network that utilizes the blockchain, a proof-of-work algorithm, and a set of consensus rules. But what does all that mean? Let's break it down. First, what is blockchain? Blockchain is one of the technologies Bitcoin uses to operate, and it is essentially a growing list of transaction records called blocks that are linked by cryptography. Each block consists of three things. First, a hash. A hash is a function that converts an input of letters and numbers into an encrypted output of a fixed length. Second, a hash of the previous block. And third, transaction data, a sender, a receiver, and the sent amount. That way, the blocks are linked, and if you try to change anything within a block, for example, a sent amount, the hash of the block will change, and with it, the hash of the next block, since each block contains the hash of the previous block. So, in order to change the block, you'd have to change the blockchain. Exactly how blocks are created we'll cover in a bit. Second, Bitcoin is distributed, meaning that each computer in the Bitcoin network has its own copy of the blockchain, which in turn means that to manipulate the information stored on the blockchain, one would need to manipulate every single copy in the blockchain network. This obviously makes the Bitcoin network extremely safe and resilient. Third, Bitcoin is anonymous. Well, kinda. That means that participants are not required to provide any ID to use the system. However, even though Bitcoin is essentially anonymous, all transactions are permanently stored on the blockchain and they can be linked to actual owners. Fourth, Bitcoin is decentralized. That means that there is no central entity in charge of processing transactions or issuing new stock of BTC. Currently, there's over 18.5 million Bitcoin in circulation, and the hard cap, or the maximum number of units that will ever exist, is 21 million, after which no more new supply will ever be mined. But we'll have to wait for that a bit, since the last fraction of BTC will be mined around the year 2140. Let me make a small digression here. There's a difference between Bitcoin and Bitcoin. Bitcoin with capitalization is used to describe the concept of Bitcoin, or the entire network itself. However, Bitcoin without capitalization is used to describe Bitcoins as a unit of account. Fifth, Bitcoin is a peer-to-peer network. This is one of the key parts of the Bitcoin protocol. P2P network is one in which two or more computers share files with no need of a separate server. In the Bitcoin protocol, it means that it needs no intermediaries to operate, since peers or nodes all have a copy of the blockchain which stores every single transaction ever made on the network. Just a fun fact, the entire Bitcoin blockchain is over 350 gigabytes in size and you can download it on bitcoin.org. I'll leave the link in the description so you can download it, check it out, or maybe even run a node. Sixth, proof of work. Proof of work is, by definition, a piece of data that is difficult to produce but easy to verify. Within the Bitcoin protocol, it is used for block generation, that is, to confirm transactions and to extend the existing blockchain with new blocks. Also, it is Bitcoin's solution to the double spending problem, which we'll cover later in this video. It works as follows. Computers, or miners, all over the network solve mathematical problems or puzzles to verify transactions, which are then stored within blocks. The process is also called hashing, and what it is basically a lottery, as miners race against each other trying to create a hash with a certain number of zeros in front of the hash, and probability of getting one is very low, so it takes time to come up with a solution, which is proof of work. The time required depends on the miner's hash rate, which is a total of its computing power. The process of adding a block to the blockchain is called mining, and the average time needed to generate a new block is 10 minutes. But if time needed to generate a new block depends on the total hash rate, what happens if the hash rate doubles? Does it suddenly take half as much time to generate a new block? The answer is yes, but only for a while, thanks to something called mining difficulty adjustment. Mining difficulty adjustment makes mining more or less difficult depending on whether the total hash rate has increased or decreased since the last adjustment. It occurs every 2016 blocks, or roughly every 2 weeks. When a new block is added to the blockchain, a miner who guessed the solution first gets the mining reward, which is now 6.25 BTC. In the beginning of the Bitcoin network, the mining reward was 50 Bitcoin. But every 210,000 blocks, or roughly every 4 years, an event called the halving occurs, which reduces the mining reward by 50%, thus reducing the new supply released into the market by 50%, and with it, the inflation, which is, by the way, at this point lower than that of gold. And seventh, consensus. The purpose of a consensus mechanism is to bring all the nodes into agreement in an environment where the nodes don't trust each other. Nodes always consider the longest chain to be the correct one and will keep on extending it. One way to abuse the consensus mechanism is called a 51% attack, which occurs when the attacker acquires a majority of total network hash rate, which would grant him more computing power, resulting in creation of a chain longer than the original one, which in turn, by the consensus rules, makes it the actual blockchain. Even though transactions within the Bitcoin blockchain are essentially irreversible, with 51% attack, the attackers could hypothetically be able to reverse them, but it would require an enormous amount of money and energy. So no successful 51% attack has ever been carried out on the Bitcoin blockchain so far. And the more the total hash rate increases, the safer the network becomes. So, to summarize, Bitcoin protocol would go something like this. Imagine Alice and Bob. Alice holds 1 BTC on her address, and she decides to send it to Bob, who had just opened an address of his own. Each address has its own private and public keys. We'll dive deeper in the asymmetric encryption in a later video, but in short, public keys are used to encrypt the transaction, whereas private keys are used to sign and decrypt it. You can think of them as keys to a safe, one of which locks it and the other one unlocks it. Back to Alice. First, she needs to copy or scan Bob's address and fill in the desired amount to be sent. Then Alice uses Bob's public key to encrypt the transaction and her own private key to sign it. Thus, the transaction is created. Also, it's important to mention that public keys are obviously public and available to anybody, whereas private keys you should keep secret, because he who controls the private keys owns the Bitcoin. So, now that the transaction has been created, it is sent to the closest node. After the node receives the transaction, it is then propagated into the network and verified. Verification makes sure that the funds that are being sent really do exist, and when the transaction gets verified, it is forwarded to the mempool or memory pool, which is a pool of still unconfirmed transactions. Alice's transaction then waits for its turn to be included in the next block. Each block contains 2,000 to 3,000 transactions. Then the proof of work algorithm does its thing, the transaction gets confirmed, and it is eventually included in one of the blocks in the blockchain. After a sufficient number of confirmations, Bob can enjoy his newly received Bitcoin. All that being said, why would anyone even invent a cryptocurrency? In today's world, one needs to rely on third parties like banks or payment processors in order to transact. In one of his emails, Satoshi wrote, "The root problem of a conventional currency is all the trust that's required to make it work. The central bank must be trusted not to debase the currency, but the history of fiat currencies is full of breaches of that trust." With that in mind, cryptocurrencies were born, but it was not an easy task. Let's rewind a little bit. For decades before Bitcoin came to be, computer scientists and cryptographers were trying to create a digital currency. By late 80s, the quest for inventing a digital currency that would work resulted in forming of a notable group called the Cypherpunks. The technical roots of their ideas have been traced back to David Chaum, who introduced the idea of digital cash in his 1982 dissertation called "Computer Systems Established, Maintained, and Trusted by Mutually Suspicious Groups." In this paper lies the first ever proposal of the term blockchain that we know of. Back to the cypherpunks. Their basic ideas can also be found in a Cypherpunks manifesto written by Eric Hughes in 1993, saying, "Privacy is necessary for an open society in the electronic age. We cannot expect governments, corporations, or other large faceless organizations to grant us privacy. We must defend our own privacy if we expect to have any. Cypherpunks write code. We know that someone has to write software to defend privacy, and we're going to write it." If you want me to cover the Cypherpunks in detail in the future, let me know in the comments below. The Cypherpunks even started a mailing list in 1992, which consisted of many prominent cryptographers of their age. Most notable products of this community were, just to name a few and in no particular order, David Chaum's DigiCash, Hal Finney's reusable proof of work, Wei Dai's B-Money, Nick Szabo's BitGold, Adam Back's HashCash. But none of them solved all the problems a digital currency might run into. The previously mentioned double spending problem in particular, which occurs when a malicious user tries to send the same funds to two addresses at the same time. The first currency to have solved the issue was Bitcoin, using proof-of-work algorithm similar to Hal Finney's reusable proof-of-work. Let's go back to Alice and Bob. Let's say Alice wants to send one Bitcoin to Bob, and immediately after she does, she wants to send the same Bitcoin to Charlie. If Alice manages to create both of those transactions, both of them will end up in a pool of unconfirmed transactions, or the mempool. And what happens next is, quote, "As the Bitcoin blockchain updates, so do all the wallets," which means that if one of your transactions gets verified within the current block, the other one will be recognized as invalid through the confirmation process of the next block. Even if both of your transactions get pulled from the pool for the confirmation process of the same block, the one that gets the highest number of confirmations will be included in the blockchain, while the other one will be discarded. This, of course, is a huge accomplishment. And it seems fitting that Hal Finney, the inventor of the reusable proof-of-work algorithm, is the second person to ever mine Bitcoin after Satoshi. But even many years after publishing of the Bitcoin white paper, nobody knows who Satoshi Nakamoto is or are, and it remains one of the biggest mysteries in the cryptocurrency space. Some people believe that Hal Finney himself was the one behind it, some others that it was Nick Szabo, the inventor of BitGold, and some others still that it was the FBI. At this point, we can only keep guessing. But I'll reveal my suspect within this series, so make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any clues along the way. Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, make sure to leave a like. And also, if you want me to cover a specific topic in the future, let me know in the comment section below. Keep mining, and I'll see you in another block.